This production is brought to you by the Fresno Mycology Society.
Whether you're wanting to contribute to the field of mycology at large or simply wanting to identify that mystery mushroom that's been popping up in your yard, this video will give you a roadmap to do just that, regardless of your level of expertise. Let's do it. First and foremost, know that this video is not an exhaustive list of steps and techniques, but is intended to be a baseline procedure for the average person. Nor is it necessary for all the preceding steps to be followed to successfully identify a mushroom. The level of rigor expands and contracts with the ambiguity of each specimen. Also, know that some areas have special regulations on collecting mushrooms, so be aware of the laws in your area. Here we found a gorgeous mushroom, in the middle of summer no less. Now before we pick it, there's a couple things we should do. First, take a couple of pictures which show its growth habit, as well as its habitat. Second, take either a physical or a strong mental note of the environment the specimen is growing in, paying special attention to the trees nearby. This information of habit, habitat, and associated tree species can all be key in identifying your mushroom. But now that we've done all that, let's go ahead and pick it. When collecting a mushroom for the sake of identification, we want to do so in a manner that provides the most taxonomically useful information. This means collecting the whole thing, down at the base, and not simply cutting it off at the ground. An old knife is perfect for prying up a deep stem. These paper lunch bags are great at keeping mushrooms in good shape on their way home. Avoid using sealed plastic bags, as they trap humidity, which tends to rapidly deteriorate most mushrooms. Also remember to cover up any holes you might make when pulling up your mushroom. For small or fragile specimens, these little compartment boxes are great. Throw in a little moss or grass to keep the mushrooms from getting too banged up. Now we're back home, and we can start the real work of describing our specimens. We'll go more in depth in a future video on the macromorphologies that distinguish mushrooms, things like gill shape and attachment, cap ornamentation, and so on. For now, I'll leave a link down below to a document that describes these various morphologies. After you've described these features, it's time to investigate the less obvious characteristics. First thing we can do is take a spore print. If you have several of a particular specimen and don't mind sacrificing one, you can cut the stem just below the gills. Otherwise, you can just lean the whole mushroom onto a sheet of aluminum foil. I like using aluminum foil rather than paper because both pale and dark spores contrast well on it, and it's also a lot easier to scrape out the spores for the next step. Go ahead and leave a small lid on top of the specimen to keep it from drying out too fast. Now, if you don't have a microscope, getting the spore color en masse from a spore print is still very important on its own. But if you do, go ahead and drop a bit of water on the periphery of the print and stir the spores off the surface. I'm using a Loupe here, but a toothpick works fine. Then, transfer the suspended spores to a slide, add a cover slip, and observe. The spore shape, size, and ornamentation are all highly valuable pieces of data. Moving on, we can test for a couple of reactions. 10% potassium hydroxide, or KOH, is a common reagent used in mycology that, when applied to certain tissues, often produces color reactions that are, you guessed it, highly valuable taxonomic markers. Here you can see the mushroom is staining a distinct yellow color from the KOH. This reaction is listed in most field guides for each mushroom. KOH can also be ordered online without any issue. The next thing we could check to see is if the mushroom bruises any particular color, simply by running your fingernail across the cap or stem. Like the KOH reaction, this mushroom also bruises yellow. So now that we've collected a good deal of information, we can consult some field guides to try and at least narrow down the identity of this mushroom. Most people stop here, but I would urge you to take it a step further and catalog your findings in one of two platforms, Mushroom Observer and iNaturalist. Both are community-based identification catalogs, while the latter also employs AI recognition with astonishing accuracy and makes confident identification even easier. Let's quickly walk through both platforms. Starting with iNaturalist, after you've created your account, you can upload photos of your observations here. If you upload more than one photo at a time, it will make separate observations for each. So if they're all of the same specimen, go ahead and combine them into one. Next, and most importantly, you can select the species name box, and it will automatically give you iNaturalist's AI species suggestions based on its visual similarities to other observations. I think you'll be impressed by its accuracy. You can add the location to your observation, making it as vague or specific as you'd like. Add any additional notes you might have and submit your observations. From there, the iNaturalist community will either confirm your initial ID or suggest a different one. Now let's move on to the second platform. Like before, in Mushroom Observer, go ahead and create your account and then click Create Observation in the left-hand box. Once there, you'll be asked to enter various pieces of information, such as where you found it, what you think it is, and how confident you are of your ID. Then it'll offer you various boxes to check if you add the relevant information, such as how you recognized it, what guide or source you used to make the ID, what if any microscopic features did you find, any chemical reactions, and finally if the specimen is available. If you're interested, I can make a video in the future about creating a personal herbarium and how to preserve mushrooms for scientific study, but for now we'll ignore it. You can upload photos of your observations here. At the bottom of the page, if you're part of any project, a checkbox will appear if you'd like to include it in that project. If you live in the Central Valley area of California, I'd love it if you would join our Mycoflora project. You can do this by submitting your Mushroom Observer account name to our webpage at fresnomycology.org under the Mycoflora tab. By doing this, you will help us create an open source, community-based catalog of our native fungi. This is a great way to contribute to the field of mycology as a citizen scientist, and is a project that I'm very excited about. In iNaturalist, we also have a Mycoflora project, and any fungal observations made in the area will automatically be listed. So now we've learned how to go about identifying and cataloging mushrooms, and I hope you find this information instructive. For me, going through this process is like a treasure hunt. At the end of the map may be a new gourmet edible, a medicinal or toxic mushroom. But beyond the purely utilitarian perspective, I think simply knowing the names of these species is intrinsically enriching. With each new member we recognize, the forest grows in its dimension of depth, and as its observers, it grows a little bigger. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like and subscribe to our channel for more videos like it. If you live in the Central Valley area and want to connect with us, you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Flickr, or at our website at fresnomycology.org. If you'd like to help us create more videos like this one, you can become a patron on Patreon. All of these will be linked below. A very special thank you to Rose and Vincent, our first patrons, our graphic design artists Jasmine Parker and Kale Livingston, and to all of you for watching. Thank you so much for your time. Happy hunting.